Good morning, Wonder. In the last class, we had discussed about minimum error classifier. Let us have a recap of that one. Minimum error classifier. Let us consider that there are C number of classes, omega 1, omega 2, and so on up to omega C. Total C classes, C number of classes, and the input feature vector is represented by x bar d cross 1, d dimensional feature vector, and let us denote the prior probabilities. As P of omega 1, P of omega 2, and so on, P of omega c. These are the prior probabilities for the classes. And the likelihood functions, they are fx bar of x bar after omega 1. This is class 1 likelihood function, and so on. This corresponds to class c likelihood function. Class C likelihood function. These are the joint probability density functions. If x is a continuous, x bar belongs to R d cross 1. Each and every feature in this feature vector can take any real number. If that is the case, you can represent as joint probability density functions. They are C jointly. Joint probability density functions. In such scenarios, we can have our minimum error classifier, which is also called as matching a posteriori probability classifier. That can be written as follows: I star equals to arg max prior probability multiplied by likelihood function implies that omega I star is the optimal classifier, optimal class for the given input vector x bar d cross 1. For this given input vector x bar, is omega I star is the optimal class if you apply that minimum error classification rule or map classification rule. But in order to apply this matching a posteriori probability classifier, we should know what is our prior probability and we should know what is our likelihood function. Once you know these two things, then you can apply map classifier to get that optimal class for the given input feature vector x bar. It means we need to compute our prior probabilities and likelihood functions first. This can be done with the help of the training samples. The computation of probability of omega j and this likelihood function can be done or can be estimated by using training data or training samples. With the help of training data, the two distributions can be computed. Let us see how to compute probability distribution functions for the basic cases. Let's assume that we have a coin with us. And using coin toss experiment, we need to find the probability of head. once you got the probability of head, probability of tail is nothing but 1 minus probability of head, because total probability is 1, right? That is same as 1 minus p. In this case, unknown thing is p. Once you know p, we can compute probability of tail as 1 minus p. This can be called as unknown parameter for the estimation. We need to estimate this unknown parameter with the help of few experiments or few training samples. Those experiments are called as training samples in this case. Suppose if you toss a coin for n times, if you toss the coin for n times and you got n h heads out of n tosses and n t tails out of these n tosses, then probability of head can be computed like this, n h by n, and probability of tail equals to n t by n, or you can write like 1 minus probability of head, anything is fine. This one we are trying to call it like p, t equal to p of h equals to n h by n p, number of heads divided by total number of tosses. In general, this n value should be large. In order to get the view of this one, let's try to understand this. Suppose if you toss a coin two times and if you got head and head in those two times, it doesn't mean that probability of head equal to 1. It doesn't mean that this one. Suppose if you toss the coin for 3 times and if you got all heads, it doesn't mean that probability of head equal to 1. The reason for this one is, even though probability of tail is not 0, if you toss the coin 3 times with some non-zero probability, you can get all heads, right? For example, let's have a look into this one. If there is a fair coin, for example, that is a fair coin means probability of head equals to probability of tail equals to 1/2. In this case, let us see the probability of occurrence of all three heads. If you toss that for thrice, three independent tosses, 1/2 × 1/2 × 1/2, right? With 1/2 cube, with 1/8 probability, you can get all these three tosses as heads. First three tosses as a head, right? It doesn't mean that probability of tail is 0. Still the probability of tail is 1/2, right? In order to have the better estimation of probability of head, n should be very large. For example, just for our convenience, and trying to start with this number, let's assume that for n equal to 10^5, for these many tosses, we can get the reasonable estimation for our probability of head, n h by n, where n equals 10^5. This will try to give the reasonable estimation for our probability of head. Let's have some assumption, any some large value like 10^5. In this example, in order to estimate single parameter p, we are going for 10^5 samples. 10^5 training samples, this can be called as 10^5 experiments or 10^5 training samples. With the help of 10^5 training samples, we are trying to estimate single parameter p, which is same as p of h, that is equal to nh by n. For example, in some other experiment, let's consider throwing dice. Dice means the outcome can be either 1, 2, 3, 4, 5 or 6. One out of these 6 possibilities is the outcome of this dice. And if our task is to find what is the probability of 1 and probability of 2, probability of 3, probability of 4, probability of occurrence of 5 and probability of occurrence of 6. If this is your task, with the help of training samples, training samples is nothing but with the help of some experiments over this dice, throwing dice. Can you try to think how many parameters are there for the estimation purpose in this case? Let's go back to this one. Here you are having probability of head and probability of tail, but once you know probability of head, you can estimate probability of tail, right? Probability of tail equal to simply 1 minus p. If you call p the probability of head, that means if you estimated probability of head, then you can estimate probability of tail by default. Similarly, here also you can do the same thing. If you are able to estimate these 5 probabilities, if you are able to estimate p of 1, p of 2, p of 3, p of 4, p of 5, then p of 6 can be found with the help of these 5, right? P of 6 is nothing but 1 minus sigma I equals to 1 to 5 p of I, because the total probability is 1, right? P of 1 plus p of 2 plus p of 3 and so on plus p of 6 equals to 1. From there you can have this one. Once you are able to estimate these 5 parameters, the 6th one we can compute with the help of these 5 parameters. In this case, we need to estimate 5 parameters in total. Now try to compare with this one. Just for a single parameter estimation, you are going for 10 power 5 training samples. Now, for the reasonable estimation of these 5 parameters in the dice experiment, you need to go for roughly 5 into 10 power 5 training samples or experiments, right? These many training samples you need to consider for this dice experiment in order to estimate those 5 parameters. And let's go to joint probability mass function. Another example, joint probability mass function. For example, you are having 10 random variables x1, x2 and so on up to x10, and each of them can take one of these values, either 0 or 1. This can take either 0 or 1, this can take either 0 or 1, this can also take either 0 or 1. Then how many parameters you need to estimate in this case? How many probabilities you need to estimate for this particular joint distribution? The number of possibilities you are having are, you are having 10 blanks, right? X1, X2 and so on, X10. 10 blanks you are having. First, everyone can take 0, right? These are the possibilities. Next case, all are zeros except last one. Next case, all are zeros except last but one. Like that, you can go up to all ones. Total number of possibilities you are having are 2 power 10 possibilities. Because this can take either 0 or 1, right? 2 into 2 into 2 into and so on 2. Total 2 power 10 possibilities, that is same as 1024 probabilities you need to estimate, right? 1024 probabilities means probability that x1 equal to 0, x2 equal to 0 and so on, x10 equal to 0, the first one, until probability of x1 equal to 1, x2 equals to 1 and so on, x10 equals to 1. You need to find all these 1024 probabilities. You need to estimate these probabilities with the help of training data or training samples. But if you are able to estimate first 1023 probabilities, you can find this last one with the help of first 1023 probabilities, right? Because sum of the probabilities is 1. This one is nothing but 1 minus sum of these probabilities, all 1023 possibilities. That means you need to estimate 1023 parameters. 1023 parameters you need to estimate from the training data. Now if you go with the same assumption, like each parameter may require roughly 10 power 5 samples. If you go with that assumption, then roughly your number of training samples should be 1023 into 10 power 5. This many number of samples, this many number of training samples is required to estimate the joint probability mass function. That many number of samples you require, number of training samples you require. Instead of this one, let's assume that they are independent, x1, x2 and so on, x10 are independent random variables. If they are independent random variables, we can simply go with this x1, x2 and so on, x10. This joint probability mass function is nothing but p of x1 into p of x2 into and so on p of x10. Product of marginal distributions. Like that you can do if they are independent random variables. In that scenario, this need one parameter for estimation, this need one parameter for estimation, and last one required one parameter for estimation, because the number of possibilities in this case are probability of x1 equal to 0 is one possibility, x1 equals to 1 is another possibility. If you know this probability, this can be estimated simply as follows: 1 minus p of x1 equal to 0. If you know this one, you can find this, right? Because total probability is 1 even for these marginals also, so that you can estimate only one parameter. Here also one parameter you need to estimate, here also you need to estimate one parameter. Total just 10 parameters you need to estimate, just 10 parameters you need to estimate when they are independent random variables. You need to estimate just 10 parameters. Now let's try to look into the number of training examples that you require. In this case, roughly 10 into 10 power 5 training examples you require. But earlier, when they are dependent, you need to go for this many number of training examples or this many number of experiments. It's roughly 100 times, right? If you call this like n, this will become like 100 into n. That many number of samples, training samples are required, right? That's the advantage of independency assumption. If they are actually independent, that's good for you, right? You require less training data to know the distribution of those random variables. That's a good thing for you, right? With less data, you can compute your probability mass function, a joint probability mass function, with less training data itself. No need to go for very huge amount of training data. That's the benefit you are going to get with this independency. Till now we have discussed about discrete random variables only. Now let's have a look into continuous random variable. Let's assume that we need to estimate probability density function for a random variable x, and let's assume that x will take values from 0 to 1 only. Up to this we know x will take values from 0 to 1 interval. This is x. Say 0 to 1. This should be probability density function. This y coordinate is the probability density function fx of x, x coordinate is x. X can take values from 0 to 1. The area under this curve should be equal to 1. This is a probability density function, right? Let's assume that we know only this thing, we don't know this PDF. we need to estimate the PDF with the help of given training samples. Let us see how to estimate that one. For example, we have given with 1000 training samples. 1000 training samples means you have done the experiment for 1000 times, for example, or you collected 1000 samples by doing the experiments like x1, x2 and so on up to x1000, and each one of them can be any number between 0 to 1. This can be any number between 0 to 1. This also can be any number between 0 to 1. Each one of them can be any number between 0 to 1. With the help of these experimental outcomes, or with the help of these training samples, we need to estimate the concerned probability density function. Let us see how to compute that one. Before going to that one, let's try to imagine how many points are there between 0 and 1. It's a real line, right? 0 to 1, there are uncountably infinite real points are there, 0 to 1 interval. And if you want to estimate the probability of occurrence of each and every point in this one, at least you need to do infinite number of experiments, right? If you want to see each and every point at least once, if you want to see each and every point in this one at least once after doing the experiment, then you need to do infinitely many number of experiments, because the number of points itself is uncountably infinite. So it looks like infeasible for you to do this experiment, right? In such scenario, what we can do is we can try to partition this into some intervals. For example, you can try to have partitions for every 0.1 interval, 0 to 0.1, 0.1 to 0.2, 0.2 to 0.3, and so on, 0.3 to 0.4, like this. And this is 0.9 to 1. You are simply dividing this entire interval into 10 parts, 10 uniform parts. Like that we had done. We had divided into 10 parts. Now, what we are going to do is, we will try to look for this probability that x belongs to 0 to 1. This is nothing but number of samples in 0 to 1 interval. The number of training samples, we have 1000 training samples, right? They are falling between, this is 0 to 0.1, is blocks, right? Number of training samples in 0 to 0.1 divided by total number of training samples. In this case, we are having 1000 training samples, right? And probability that x belongs to 0.1 to 0.2 equals to number of samples in 0.1 to 0.2 interval divided by total number of samples, 1000. Like this we can go. For example, let's assume that the number of samples between 0 to 0.1 interval, these are 50, and the number of samples between 0.1 to 0.2 are 60. Then according to this one, we can try to have probability that x belongs to 0 to 0.1 is 50 divided by total number of samples 1000. See 0.05, and the probability that x belongs to 0.1 to 0.2 is nothing but 60 divided by 1000, just same as 0.06 is the probability of this one. Like this we can compute. In the same manner we can try to compute that one, and finally we'll try to have like this. This is x, here the histogram, I want to plot histograms. Let's say this is that ratio, right? 0.05, and this is 0.06, this is 0 to 0.1 interval, 0.1 to 0.2, and let's assume that this is 0.04 till 0.3 and so on. For every 0.1 interval we are having such rectangle box. And let's assume that this one corresponds to 0.1, 0.1, 0.921, 0.921. See, the sum of these probabilities should be equal to 1. Whatever the values we are mentioning on top of them, they are the probability of occurrence, right? Probability of occurrence between 0 to 0.1, between 0.1 to 0.2, between 0.2 to 0.3, like this one, between 0.9 to 1. They are the probability of occurrences. All these sums should be equal to 1. This will lead to 1, sum leads to 1. Okay, now if you want to convert this into probability density function, then what we need to do is, we need to divide each and every height with this interval. You can see, probability means area under this curve, right? Probability that 0 to 0.1, you can try to recollect x less than 0.1 equals to area under that curve, right? That is nothing but area under the curve. Integral fx of x dx, x from 0 to 0.1. Area under this probability density function from 0 to 1. Area under this curve from 0 to 1, 0 to 0.1 interval. That should be same as 0.05. Area means this is the area, right? This area should be 0.05. If you are expecting this area to be 0.05, in this case area is nothing but 0.05 multiplied with 0.1. This width is 0.1, right? If you want to make this like 0.05, we need to normalize this by 0.1, right? This 0.1 gets cancelled out and you are going to get 0.05. Similarly, this also should be normalized by 0.1. Everyone should be divided by 0.1. This interval gap is there, right? Divide by 0.1, divide by 0.1, divide by 0.1, divide by 0.1. If you do divide by 0.1 for this one, then we are going to get 0.5. This is 0.6, this is 0.4, and this is 1. After division by this 0.1 interval, this corresponds to approximate probability density function. If you want to get better approximation to this probability density function, instead of going for 0.1 intervals, you can try to go for somewhat finer interval, 0.01. If you try to divide this 0 to 1 interval with intervals of 0.01, you need to divide this into 100 parts, right? We are going to have 100 partitions total. 100 parts. Each part corresponds to 0.01. Total 100 parts. If you want to think, you can try to assume this like a parameter estimation. Like as in your dice experiment, your unit estimate total 6 probabilities, right? Probability of 1, probability of 2, probability of 3, and some probability of 6. Out of 6, if you are estimating 5 parameters, that's enough, right? In a similar manner, here you are trying to estimate 10 parameters. Total you are having 10 parameters with you. This is one parameter, x from 0 to 0.1, this is one parameter. X from 0 to 0.1 to 0.2, another parameter. X from 0.2 to 0.3, another parameter, and so on. X from 0.9 to 1, this is one more parameter. You are having total 10 parameters. If you are able to estimate 9 parameters out of 10, then you can estimate that 10th parameter, right? The 10th parameter you can estimate. 1 minus sum of all those parameters. It means if you go with this one, you need to estimate 9 parameters, roughly. If you go with this one, you need to estimate 99 parameters. And if you want to make it much finer, if you want to approximate that probability density function much accurately, then you need to go for further smaller interval. If you go for 0.001 interval, then your number of parameters for the estimation purpose are 999 parameters. And we are seeing something, right? As the number of parameters are increasing, the number of samples that you required also keeps on increasing, right? For example, for each parameter, if you require 10 power 5, with 0.1 interval, you may require 9 to 10 power 5 training samples. With 0.01 interval, you may require 99 into 10 power 5 training samples. With 0.01 interval, if you want to approximate that actual PDF perfectly, you need to go for smaller and smaller intervals. But the drawback we are going to get is, you need to go for this many number of training samples. Training samples are keeps on increasing, right? Into 10 for this, into 10 for this, like that. The number of training samples that you require are becoming so huge, right? The training data you require is so huge. There's a drawback with this one. If you want to go for better estimation, you are simply going for smaller intervals. But the problem you are going to get is, if you are going for smaller intervals, you need to go for more number of training samples. That's the drawback we are going to get with this. There should be some trade-off between them, right? That should not completely deviate from your actual probability density function. But at the same time, the number of training samples required also should not be so high, right? You need to have some trade-off between them. You should not go for too small interval, or you should not go for too big interval. That should be in between somewhere, so that you can approximate reasonably well with the help of some small or medium number of training data, training samples. See, just with single variable. Now try to imagine about this one, f x bar of x bar. Let's assume that x bar is d cross 1 feature vector, input feature vector, d cross 1 input feature vector. And try to think about this one. How many such partitions you require, or how many parameters you need to estimate? For example, just for our convenience, let's assume that each and every feature in this x1, x2 and so on, xd, this is nothing but your x bar. Let's assume that d equal to 100, for example. d equal to 100. Just for example, d equal to 100 is an input feature vector. We want to find the joint product density function for this feature vector for the given class. For example, class 1 f of x bar, after knowing that is from class 1, you want to estimate this likelihood function. In that scenario, let's go with each feature belongs to 0 to 1. For example, just for our convenience, each feature can take value from 0 to 1. Now if you go for very basic level like 0.1 partitioning, this one you are trying to divide into intervals of 0.1, 0 to 0.1, 0.1 to 0.2, and so on, 0.9 to 1. 10 parts we are doing, right? Similarly, we'll do 10 parts for this and 10 parts for this one. If you do in that manner, the number of possible parameters you need to estimate are 10 into 10 into 10 into and so on 10. That equal to 10 power 10. This means e number of parameters you need to estimate when coming to that joint distribution. 10 power 10. It's not 10 power 10, right? It's 10 power 100. We have total 100 features in this case. 10 power 100. That many parameters you need to estimate. Then think about training data. You may require this much training data, right? It's very, very huge. It's not at all possible, right? It's not at all possible. In order to avoid this problem, what we can do is, we can simply try to represent these PDFs with the help of some parameters. For example, if I am able to represent this as a Gaussian distribution with mean mu bar and correlation covariance matrix sigma. Here mu bar is d cross 1 and covariance matrix is d cross d. If I am able to represent this something like a Gaussian distribution, jointly Gaussian distribution, then if I am able to estimate these parameters, then I can represent my entire joint probability distribution function, right? If I am able to estimate these parameters. Now instead of estimating this distribution directly, I will try to estimate the parameters. Now you can see the number of parameters required for us. Let's go with that earlier example only. If d equal to 100, for example, the dimension of that feature vector is 100, in that case, the number of parameters in this are 100, because d equal to 100, right? It's a vector. In this case, the number of parameters are 100 into 100. This is 10 power 4. But it's not the actual one. We already know that sigma transpose equal to sigma. This covariance matrix is symmetric in nature. Roughly, you may require divided by 2, the many number of parameters for the estimation, right? Divided by 2. Roughly, it's not exact one. It means 5 to 10 power 3 parameters plus 100 parameters. 5,100 parameters. See, instead of estimating 10 power 100 parameters, we are trying to estimate just 5,100 parameters. It looks very, very low value, right? 5,100 is much, much smaller than 10 power 100. These many parameters only I need to estimate. That's the advantage of modeling your probability density function with the help of few parameters. If you are able to model your probability density function with the help of few such parameters, like in our Gaussian case, mean and variance, then we can try to estimate the effective probability density function with the help of small training data set only. No need to go for very very huge training data. In this case, roughly you can go with 5100 into 10 power 5. This much training samples is enough, right? Instead of going for 10 power 100 into 10 power 5 training samples, you can simply go with these many training samples only. It's a benefit we are going to get, right? Thank you.